So now we start a very interesting topic in the course called dynamic programming. It will keep us busy for the next few classes. It's covered in chapter 6 of the textbook. Very briefly, dynamic programming was pioneered by this person, Richard Beltman. He was an applied mathematician. Later in his life, he started working more on biology, medicine, and you can find more about his life in this Wikipedia article, as well as where the term dynamic programming comes from. It's not about programming as in software programming, it's programming in terms of the optimization literature. You may have heard about linear programming, integer programming, nonlinear programming. So all of these are methods for solving optimization problems, and dynamic programming is one of those branches in optimization theory. So there are really hundreds of applications of dynamic programming. Every time you're using the internet, the main routing protocol of the internet, BGP, is using a version of the Bellman-Ford algorithm for routing. Anytime you use your cell phone or anything that uses something called Viterbi codes, they are basically using dynamic programming for training some hidden Markov models. Anytime you use a compiler, the parser of the compiler uses dynamic programming, and the list goes on. Let's try to understand the high-level idea of dynamic programming by contrasting it, first of all, with two other approaches you have seen so far. You have seen so far greedy algorithms that are, in some sense, very simple. They basically build up the solution myopically by moving at each step of the algorithm in the direction at which they expect to get the maximum benefit. Then we talked about divide and conquer algorithms. Remember, they essentially have a tree structure in mind, where you start with a problem, the original problem you want to solve of some size, and you split it into sub-problems, one or more, and these problems are smaller. And this keeps going all the way until you have some trivial problem size. Often use recursion to compute the solution of this problem using the solutions of these subproblems. This works in a small number of problems, relatively speaking, but for many other problems, it doesn't really give you a benefit to divide and conquer. So what is the basic idea of dynamic programming at a very high level? Again, you have the notion that you break the problem into a number of subproblems. Of course, these subproblems should be a polynomial number of such problems, polynomial with respect to the size of the input. If you have an exponential number of problems, then you will end up with an exponential time algorithm. The similarity with divide and conquer is that, again, here in dynamic programming, there is a recursive equation that says how you can solve a certain problem of size n as a function of the solution of smaller problems. So that is a similarity with divide and conquer. But here, instead of having a tree structure that represents how these problems are related, we have a directed acyclic graph. So remember this, for a dynamic program, any dynamic programming problem, there is an underlying directed acyclic graph that shows how these problems are related. So the nodes are problems, not anything else, and the edges represent how one problem relates to another. Suppose that we have a function, I will use the same terminology with your textbook, called OPT for optimum. And it can be a function of one or more variables that represent the size of that subproblem. So this function is the optimal solution. It gives the optimal solution of a subproblem of size I. Now, for some trivial problem sizes, for example, when I is equal to 1, you may know what is this function. You may easily argue what is the base case. For larger problem sizes, you can have a recursive equation that expresses the solution as some more complicated function here of solutions of problems that are of smaller sizes. So all of these subproblems here, J1 all the way to JK, all of these are smaller than I. So this recursive equation, of course, is what we will spend most of our time trying to figure out. For each problem, it's different. So let's try to show this visually. Imagine a directed acyclic graph where the nodes are solutions to problems of different sizes. So this node here represents the solution of the subproblem of size I. And imagine here that we have other subproblems starting from the simplest problem of size 1. Here we have the problem I minus 1. The DAG that I was talking about shows how this problem depends on specific, not all, but specific subproblems of smaller size. So in order to solve a dynamic program, you need to do two things. One is to figure out which are these subproblems, right? That's not always trivial. And then you need to come up with this recursion that expresses how you can solve a problem of a given size as a function of problems of smaller size, which can be represented, as I said, with a DAG. So a dynamic program does not use recursion. You start from a small problem, small I, and you move towards larger I until, of course, you solve the original problem that you started with,